choose being was energy sapping and took a lot out of you. Was it difficult then to, you know, be as focused for the Bury game, or was the fact that it was because promotion was on the cards?
That I think if we were mid-table, then that would have just been a damp scrub, you know, and just gone out of it. But because of what was at stake the next game, or what we had to do, I think it helped. You know, it helped for the 5,000 or 6,000 fans to go up that week after. By winning that last game, it sort of kept them in buoyant mood and made them want to do it more and want to get up there more.
The amount of fans we brought, we took over the ground. So atmosphere-wise, it was like a home game.
Yeah, Mum and Dad went to that game, and I think I rang them just before or when we were travelling up, and they were already up there, and they were like, "You're not going to believe this." And I was like, because we knew there was going to be loads of bands there, but I don't think we quite knew what it was going to be like. And then she said, basically, you're going to be playing a home game. I said, what do you mean? She said, I can't see any Bury fans. She said, all I can see is Swansea fans, and they're everywhere. And I said, right, okay. And then we arrived, and same. It was like it wasn't like the Shrewsbury game, a carnival atmosphere, but it was a carnival atmosphere, but in a smaller scale. Do you know what I mean? I think, what was it, 5,000, 6,000 fans, 7,000? I can't remember what it was.
We stayed outside of Bury because of that reason, I think. We drove in and it was just Swansea fans everywhere. And it honestly couldn't. There was like the odd Bury fan here and there, but it just jacked everywhere. It was like, wow, this is good.
If you're looking at Bury's point of view, they don't want you celebrating at their ground. They want to spoil the party, and that's what they had to do. You know, there was... Forbes, he scored his goal, same again early on, and I do think that affected us.
We know that we can defend and make it difficult for them, and we know we've got players that can take an opportunity. We happen to take the opportunity after, what was it, 20-odd seconds or something like which time.
The ball just dropped and I could see the space in behind. It's sort of like a half-volley ping type thing over into the space. Forbes, you went along and stuck it in, and cue pitch invasion number one.
And then it took about 5 minutes to restart from that kickoff because our fans were all on the pitch. I think they thought we had won at that point.
Our fans were coming on the pitch, and even their players were trying to say to the ref, abandon the game, because they didn't want us to get promoted on their patch. So
he didn't want anybody to know what was going on elsewhere with the South End results. And we sort of, it's just one of those magical games.
And then, and we all know, like, as the game went on a little bit further, and you know, scores were coming in from, you could sense it from the crowd, and our players were going around trying to keep them off the pitch because the ref had threatened a number of times to take us off the pitch because our fans wouldn't get off the pitch. But they were in such a frenzy.
The last thing we wanted to do, they were trying to say, all right, I'll get off the pitch. And we wanted it over. We didn't want to go off and then come back because anything could happen. We just wanted it over, finish it, get it done. We win it 1-0. We got what we want. Whatever's going on elsewhere is going on elsewhere. Let's get this done. Don't sort of interrupt us now when we're in the flow and doing it. And, you know, turns and a few other, Kenny was like pushing people back.
Kenny brought me off towards the end, and then he said to me, Lee, go down and just tell him to stay off the pitch, because it was scared in case we got the game abandoned and you had to play it again. And there was literally like 5 minutes to go. So I went down and was just trying to, being a steward, trying to keep them off the pitch, and said, listen, boys, just stay off.
And then all I remember in that game was, like, once we got to the last few minutes, like, they were throwing, like, their centre-halves were coming up front, and, like, they were really going for it. And, like, I remember on the pitch, all of us, we were, like, saying to their players, what are you doing? He said, you're not playing for anything. You're mid-table, and, like, you're throwing everyone, like, centre-halves were coming up and playing up front and stuff like that. And we were getting really angry about it because we were like, yeah, we understand you win a game, but you mean you're going way over board to try and get back at us? Like, we were like, but I think that helped us because it made us angry. Do you know what I mean? And it made us even more determined then, because we took that personally. Do you know what I mean? Like, yeah, okay, we understand it's a game and you've got to compete and you want to get back into and you want to win, but they were throwing everyone up. They were taking massive risks and all these things. They were leaving no one back and stuff. And we were like, hang on a minute, you're mid-table. It's the last game of the season. Like, everything's on it for us. What are you doing? But I think that made us more determined.
And then when the final whistle went, it was then a race for me trying to get back to the halfway line to get in the tunnel, because I didn't fancy getting caught in thousands of them, I would never have got out. So I think that was the fastest run all season back to the halfway line.
And then we can talk about the celebrations with the fans coming on the pitch and stuff like that. But when we got back into the tunnel and the changing rooms, we were angry. Do you know what I mean? We were angry with them. And like, that's, I think, the same sort of situation at Boston. We were banging on their changing room, but this time we were all of us were doing it. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't just Tatey at the front, knocked it and ran. All of us were outside their door, like banging them, saying, like, what the hell were you thinking you're doing? Do you know what I mean?
Obviously, after the game, we were in this changing room. It was, like you said, Drew, we wasn't in the dressing room, but there was no, champagne or anything. There was nothing there. And we were like, so I think it was Andy Gurney who saw this. So gone upstairs in the one of the dressing room, come back with two boxes of Bud. So we all having a beer and this, that, and the other. And you've got 6,000 fans outside. Now, if it was at home, it'd be no problem to do it. So we said, look, we can see them, and they'd come back with the air, go up into the next box, we take you up there.
Just, I remember just celebrating in the changing room with the boys all together, which was great, because obviously we'd achieved something together. I know I wasn't on the pitch on the day, but still, you've been together all year, and you achieve together whether you play in that game, whether you don't. So I know it was a brilliant day for everyone, and Willie getting arrested, it just topped it off really.
Because we wanted to celebrate with the fans, but it was impossible to celebrate like that. Do you know what I mean? In there, because it was like, you know, we had to get in, and then we went up to the director's box, and then the famous Willie Garay arrest.
I was standing a couple down from him. At first, I got off onto the roof as well, and all our fans were on the pitch, and the police told me to get off.
I don't know what was going on, but the police, but they weren't happy whether what was going on with the safety issue or what. Then he's arguing with these police, typical of, no, the Frenchman again, in just arguing with him. Of course,
Willie's a big boy. So Willie's just like, police officers pushing him, and he's just looking at him like he couldn't shift him at all. Like, and then they were really trying to shift him, and another one got involved, really trying to push him, and he just wasn't moving. And then they were like, right, we're going to arrest you out of nowhere. We were like, what? And they were trying to grab his hand and like pull his other hand together to cuff him, and like they couldn't move his hand. So like another two officers come over, and they're really trying to push his hands together. Like, and Willie was just stood there like that, didn't say a word, just straight face like that, like strong guy.
Willie wasn't doing it, and then in the end, the policeman just arrested him and took him off. So Willie's getting carted off in handcuffs with no top on to the police station.
We sort of walked. I walked down, and Kenny's there, stood outside, and the gaffer's going, "Chris, all right, everything all right?" I said, "Yeah, gaffer, yeah, I liked it there." Willie's just been arrested, and he went, "Oh, what?" I said, "Yeah, he's just been arrested. I don't know what for, but he's just gone." You know, the policeman and Kenny, like, "Oh no, what's going on here?" Like, so he's just been promoted, and his keeper's been carted off in the back of a police van. Like,
he'd gone. We were celebrating in the dressing room, and then Kenny come to the coach room. He gone on and said, "Listen, Willie's in the police station."
Kenny stood up and then said, "Right, lads, we've got a decision to make. Do we go to the police station and wait for Willie, or do we put him in a taxi when he gets out and we head back home?" Instantly, because of the type of group we have, we said, "Nah, we're all going to the police station."
The gaffer goes, "Right, boys, you know me. We've got a game Wednesday. No drinking." And the bus went, "Whoa, what? Come on, gaffer, man." And everyone was arguing, "Nah, no, we're not having this. You know, okay. One or two." It's like, yeah.
So then a few of us at the front said, "Right, like, let's stop at the supermarket. We're going to get some more drink and blah, blah, blah."
One of the boys said, "Right, what's Willie drinking?" He said, I think it was Jack Daniels. Jack Daniels.
I just remember being at the police station outside, and this coach pulls up. We all got beers and stuff like that. Everyone's, you know, some are sat on the coach, some are sat out on the wall outside the police station. And then I remember everyone started chanting Free Willy, like chanting it outside the police station, Free Willy, Free Willy, Free Willy. And eventually he comes out, French, moody. Obviously, it's like half pot of tinge on his celebrations, didn't it? You know, because it was so unnecessary, like, of what happened. He was obviously in a real mood. Come on the bus, didn't say a word. He was like, "Damn, oh," and lads are like, "Oh," like, and all the lads are ready to celebrate. You know, we're all in party mode. And then he was sat there with a face on. One of the lads had brought Willie a bottle of Jack Daniels. Willie sat on the bus like this, moody, like, "My day's spoiled, blah, blah, blah." Didn't say a word. One of the lads just put a Jack Daniels in front of his face. He looked up, massive smile on his face, and then it was just party time.
I think I was on the orange WKD wickets.
And then we went back to Swansea. I think we went out. And then, brilliant night.
How much do you remember of that night?
None. None. The bus journey home was good. Funnily enough, every promotion we've had, we've always been away from home, and the bus journey coming back is always the best, because it's just you, the lads that you've been with throughout the year, worked hard together, the staff who you've worked hard for and they've worked hard for you, all together on the bus, and it's brilliant. All the promotion, I wouldn't swap them for the world, no matter where they were.
Quite a funny story. Kenny, when we were travelling back after Willie and that, Kenny stood up again at the back of, when we got to this, Swansea, and he come up to the back of the bus and he said, okay, lads, just want to say, look, brilliant achievement, done great. I'm really proud of all of you. He said, but look, you know what I'm about. He said, like, we've got an important game on Wednesday, cup game. Just have that in your mind, and I want you to be ready like that. So just think about that in your celebrations. And it was like, and not in a disrespectful way at all to Kenny, but like in an instant thought process, every single lad, like, just instantly come out of their mouth, like, just instantly went, gaffer, that, like, and then Kenny went, yeah, fair enough, like, as if like we were thinking about, you know, we just arrived back after Bury and we were going to think about the Wednesday, no chance. Like, I think Kenny tried to do the right thing, but he instantly thought, yeah, that's not a battle I'm going to win again. Like, that's where, like, we were, you know, Kenny knew when to let us be and, you know, when to go hard on us. Like, and he was like, yeah, fair enough. Like,
and after all the celebrations, it must have felt like the end of the season, but there was still one game left to play with the Welsh Cup against Wrexham. How did you prepare yourselves for that then?
Not very good, really. So we were out for 2 days before, after our celebrations. But I think, you know, Kenny sort of knew that was what we wanted to do. And I felt that game against Wrexham for us was a formality. I always believed that we were gonna go and win that anyway. Last game at the Vetch, you know, cup final, I thought we were going to go out and win it. So even with the celebrations,
our sole aim at the start of that season is to get promoted. No one ever mentioned the FAW Premier Cup as to win it. You know, we hadn't won it before, and it's, you know, it was like, right, let's get promoted. And that's what we said out there, and that's what we'd done. It was just by chance then that we got Wrexham, and it was in the thing, and it was the last game at the Vetch. So all of a sudden, it's like, should we have to go again? But it was just me and Trans were, we were going to Magaluf on the Friday.
I think there was about 10 of us ended up going. So on the morning of the final, me and Chris O'Leary were in Newport getting our passports done in a day. So we had a McDonald's breakfast for the in preparation for the Welsh Cup final.
And it was a strange, like, you know, it was, like I said, the focus had been on promotion. We'd achieved that. Now there was this added sort of another game. And I think Kenny made a couple of changes for the game. A couple of boys were struggling with, like, prolonged injuries. I don't think Monk's played in it. I'm not sure Sam Ricketts played.
I played the last three or four games with, like, real niggly groin injuries. And then I think also the celebrations didn't help.
You played an important role in that game. So your cross led to their own goal before you set up Rob for the winner. So it must have been nice to play a part in the last ever game at the Vetch.
Yeah, it was brilliant. And if I'm honest, I wanted to be the last person to score at the Vetch. You know, when we go, and that was something that I wanted to do, because then, you know, you're always in, you're in the quiz questions, you're remembered for that. And, you know, it was something that I wanted to do. But to, you know, to be a part in it, and the next best thing was Robbo scoring the last goal as well. So, you know, I was happy with that.
It was brilliant to be involved, because it was officially the last game at the Vetch, and to win it and win the FAW for the first time, because I think we went on to retain at the season after, and we got up at Wrexham. But to win it for the first time, it's still a trophy, although it's not looked on massively in any part of the UK, apart from probably Wales. You like to go and win it. It was a big moment for me personally, without sort of getting too much publicity on it.
Obviously went out and won that, so it was another celebration that night. And then we were away then for a few days to celebrate together.
And then everyone just went out. And like I said, all the lads that were sat, you know, it was probably about 5, 6, 7 of us sat in the stands that probably would have played. And then how they managed to play that game, the lads. But then they won as well. So just typified the group, didn't it? We won that game. And yeah, just a brilliant ending. And again, last game of the Vetch. And I just remember from that game afterwards, people taking seats and the centre spot and penalty spots and nets and posts and whatever they could get their hands on and trying to get memorabilia from the stadium. So yeah, what just capped off what was a big achievement for the club that season.
And onto the Magaluf trip. Is it true that you bumped into Michael Reddy, the Grimsby striker who scored against Southend, which secured the Swans' automatic promotion in Magaluf?
Yeah, we seen him out there, so obviously we grabbed him with us, saying, "Reddy, come and celebrate." Because obviously, he scored an overhead kick or something to let them win the game. So obviously, he never bought a drink. We were giving him drink. I think his last one was a big fish bowl, what we give him. And I think it was about 3 hours later, we seen him lying on the curb with the fish bowl still. So I think we finished him off on that. But, you know, obviously, he played a part in us getting promoted. So it was great to see him and have him celebrate with us.
In terms of like that season in particular, where does that kind of season rank?
That's my best season. That's the best memories I've had. And I think it just, everything was right. Like I said to you early on, where the manager at the time trusted in me, believed in me. And pretty much when I was fit, I played. Because that's, you know, he made me feel that good.
In a season in terms of where it set me up for the rest of my career, probably right up there, yeah.
I think it has to rank right up there with a few others. Just because of the situation we were all in and where we were at and the type of group that we had and, do you know what I mean? The memories we have from, you know, the memories still today, and we still talk about that today, like I said, and it has to be up there. I just think it was just such, because of the type of group we had, just made it special, made it really special. And then because of the circumstances of being the last game at the Vetch and new stadium coming, trying to get to League One, us trying to prove that we can play at a high level, knowing that, but proving it is a different thing. And I think just an accumulation of such a great group of lads. I think you have to rank it right up there because of just the way we were, do you know what I mean? And what we all gave to it and the memories that we all have from that. So yeah, it's definitely right up there with a couple of other seasons where we were successful as well.
Up there as one of the best ones because we got promoted off it as well. And I think that's what you set out to be. And, you know, even if we would have scored 15 goals in that division in that season and got promoted, you know, that would have been my main aim. So, you know, to get over this win was something that I was proud of because, you know, if you look at Bob Latchford, I think his was in 1981 or 1980, you know, for a club like Swansea to go to, what was it, 2004? Yeah, so for someone to go that long and a club like Swansea and not a forward or a player who scored 20 goals, you know, it sounds hard to believe. So it was nice to break that record and especially with Bob Latchford being an Everton legend as well, it was nice to do that.
When you look back and think of the Vetch, what three words sum it up best for you?
Hostile, enjoyable, and intimidating.
Passion, hostile, and magical.